Hey, in this one I would like to show you how you can create a daemon process on Linux or Unix operating systems in general, I assume. And yeah, what a daemon process is, it's basically just a background process, and it's usually used for like services on your system. So yeah, can't come up with an example, but everything that is in systemd, for example, is often like some kind of daemon. Or maybe not. And like, for example, Pulse Audio, like the audio manager on Linux, it's a daemon, and yeah, stuff like that. Anyway, and so the way it works is that you will have an executable that will create a process, and then the main executable will terminate, and the process you created, you never wait for it or kill it in this process, and so it just keeps on running. So this is the basic logic. So you can create a process in Linux by calling the fork system call. What fork will do, it will create a full copy. It will duplicate the memory of your current process into another one, and it will launch both processes at the same point in time, but with different value. So the parent process will actually have the value, the PID of the child in it, and the child will have a zero at this place. And of course, if there is an error, it returns minus one. So here we can assert that the child PID is different than minus one. And then if child PID is greater than zero, we're in the parent. And if we're in the parent, we can just exit already. So let's say exit success, like so. And so now we have just a child process that is just running along, and the parent process already, the one that we launched from the terminal, it's already exited. The thing is that there is a slight problem with that, is that, so for example, if you do that, like you can still reattach your terminal to the child, to the daemon process, which is might not be something you want, and so, or there is some like permissions issues, and so to solve those people use like what is called I don't know, the double fork technique. So basically you just fork a second time, and you create a new session ID. So like what a session ID is basically like you have processes that all have an ID, so PID, and then those processes can be in a process group, so the GID, I think, and those can have some permissions and whatever, and then each one of those groups can be in a session. So it's kind of like the hierarchy on Linux or Unix of process. So you have a session that can have multiple process groups that can have multiple processes. But anyway, long story short, if you do set SID for session ID, like so, it will create a new session for you. So your process will be the leader of the session. So like kind of like the process that handles other processes in the session. But like it doesn't matter too much for us. It's just that now you cannot reconnect to it from the outside. Like you cannot attach your terminal to it or do other stuff. And after you do that, you will, well, actually, here you can, but after, now you fork a second time. And again, it's the exact same logic. Check if it's different than minus one. And if it's greater than zero, that means we're in the parent, we can exit. And so here now we're in a child process that is not the session leader because we forked a second time. And so this process has now like limited privileges and you cannot reattach to it. So that's basically why we double fork. And so yeah, I can already launch this, I think. So if I do gcc main.c, and here I have, well, no, it's not that, it's a daemon example, let's say. So now I have a daemon example executable, and if I launch it, you see that, well, nothing happens. But now if I do ps aux, if I list the processes and grep this process name, you can see that there is just a daemon example process, just it's running along. And the only way we can kill it for now is just grabbing his process ID and killing it manually. And yeah, that's basically it. Yeah, you notice that I have a little infinite loop there. So yeah, but now we can implement some things that you might have already seen in like common daemon application, let's say. So one of the example is often in when you tune your configuration on Linux on a server or whatever, you might have encountered at some point those .pid files, and those files actually store the process ID of the daemon, so that other applications, when they need to interact with it, they can find his PID at some like determined place. And so the way you could do that is you could get the current process ID with get PID, like so. And then you can just open a file in PID. Let's use the open syscall daemon example. So, and often they have the extension .pid, but it doesn't matter too much. We want to create it, we want to open it in write only, and we would like to truncate it as well, like so. Forgot my notes. Yeah, of course, we can set the permissions of this file here. Again, we can assert that this file descriptor is different than minus one. If you're not familiar with file descriptor, it's just like the, let's say, the system interfaces to files instead of using file stream like fopen and so on. But it's not, yeah, it's less human readable, but it's basically the same. And then we could, I'm just going to copy paste what I have on the side, but basically what I do here is reopen, like create a file stream that we all know and love from this file descriptor, then just literally print the PID into it and close it. And so you could do this like so. And then if you launch it, you can see now that if I have a PID file, and in it is the PID of the daemon. And so you could kill it by using this file instead. And so now if you grep, it doesn't exist. A common technique as well that people use is that you don't want your daemon to be running twice. So if you launch it once, you don't want somebody to be able to start it again. And so generally what people do is they use this PID file as a kind of a lock file. So whenever the daemon exits, it closes this PID file. No, it removes it. And whenever you start, you're asking to start a new daemon, you check if this file is present, and if it's present, you just exit with an error. And the way we can do this here very easily is adding the exclu, the unpronounceable flag in the open syscall, which means that if this file already exists, just don't open it. And so we could do this. So if I now remove the PID file, compile my thing, and then run it, and then I try to run it a second time, you see that now I have an error because the PID file is present. So let's kill the thing and remove the PID. The next thing that you would like to do is now, because now if I launch the process, the daemon is still connected to my terminal somehow. So if I start printing, let's say I would like to print like the current time every second or something. Like so, here, let's do GCC again. And so, yeah, you can see that it's just printing in my terminal, which is quite annoying. And yeah, so I could like close this terminal, reopen a new one, and then it's gone. You know, I lost the output of the program, so that's not great. So we would like to put basically the process outputs on std out and std error, we would like to put that to a log file. So let's do that. Let's first kill it and then remove the PID. So let's just create a log file. This time the normal way. We can do it like so. So here, yeah, I just have a path. I do fopen in append mode. We can also check that the file is really opened. And then there is a little thing where you can call the setLineBuff function, which this is just to set like the buffering type on a file. So by default, like stdout is like line buffered. So it's like buffered in memory, and whenever you encounter a new line character, it will be flushed to your terminal or file or whatever. And yeah, I think like files by default are like block buffered, so meaning like you have a block of 4,000 something bytes, and as soon as you reach this specific size, it's flushed to the thing. But here we don't want our log file to be block buffered. We want it to be line buffered, since it's a log file. You would like to see each line appearing as they come. So this is what this does. And next, we actually have to do some things. So here we need to use some syscall on the log file. So we get the file descriptor from it. So the file NO just converts like your file stream thing that you like into like the more lower level file descriptors. And then we can use the dup2 syscall, which will basically take the file descriptor of the log file, and it will overwrite the stdout and stderror file descriptors with this one. So yeah, it has a weird name, but basically this is what it does. And so basically now every time you do printf or fprintf to stderror or anything that you print to stdout or error, it will use that file instead. And so, yeah, we now that we've done this, if we compile it again, make sure that we don't have the PID thing, make sure it's not running already. It is not. And now if I run my daemon example, you can see that nothing is printed on my terminal. But now if I tail f this daemon example.log, you can see that we have our logs in the file. It's perfect and it's nice. Anyway, that's about everything I wanted to show you in this video. On how to create daemon and do the basic operations that you would like on them. One last thing I would like to show is that this all comes from like a little project I did where I explored daemon. But one common thing that you see is like, for example, for Docker or something like that, some things like that, the daemons often create like a .soc file somewhere to communicate with them. And what a .soc file is, like a Unix socket. So it's kind of like, it's like mimicking networking, but without a network. I don't know, okay, that's a terrible description, but basically it's kind of a file that acts as something that you can like receive and send from, like you would do on the network. And you often see these daemons use those files to be able to have a daemon, and then you have a client. So like the Docker command line is the client, and then the Docker D is the daemon. Here you can see that, for example, I also create, there we go, I think. Here, I create a socket of type sock stream, and then we can set some stuff to make it Unix and whatever, and pick wherever it will go, in which file, and so on and so on. So yeah, you can do that as well. And that's about all that I wanted to say on daemons. I hope you learned something, and see you on the next one.